I bought a 1993 Land Rover Discovery, sight unseen from the other side of the country, and it is mint. Oh yeah, there she is.
Hooray! Yay!
This photo was taken 5 minutes after meeting the guy at the airport and driving away. I took a bunch of camera gear with the intention of making an epic travel home video, but both flights were delayed and I didn't pick up the vehicle until 2:30 in the afternoon. It's midwinter in New Zealand, the sun sets at 5, and I had a long drive to get home. My main concern was this rural wilderness. If I had to break down in this sheep-infested Darien gap, I would prefer that to happen during daylight. So I forgot about videos and hit the road. As it turns out, I made it through to the relative civilization of the Waikato without issue, and stopped for a well-earned kebab. This is when it got dark, and I learned that only one of the four headlights work, and there's no way to demist the windscreen, because everything is broken. Aside from being cold because I had to keep a window down for the rest of the journey home, I made it back without incident. Anyway, enough story time. Let's have a look at it. As you can see, it's not too bad. No, it's a piece of shit. This horrible bull bar is obviously going to go. Ooh, genuine heller. Worth $5. Neither of the spotlights work. This headlight doesn't work and is full of condensation. This one works, so that's pretty good. Headlight washers, fancy, doubt they work. And missing a badge. Ooh, cable tie, I wonder what that's doing. Now, down the sides of the vehicle. This side, the driver's side or chicken side, is perfect. I think it's all original paint. I don't even think there's a dent anywhere. Nothing to complain about here. The passenger side, a bit of a different story. They were much braver with this side of the vehicle. First of all, there's some minor dentage on the front fender, and the rear quarter is a little messed up too. We've got a bit of a ridge here, some cracked bog down here. No problem, that'll glue back down. In fact, I think this rear quarter may be a replacement. Early in the vehicle's history, I would guess, judging by the paint. I say that because it's sitting a little lower than the panels around it, and this up here doesn't look like a factory sealant job. Oh, and I don't know if you noticed, but two of the doors are a different color. Obviously these came from a different vehicle that was this color, but that's not the funny part. These doors were originally teal, and then I guess someone with a brown Land Rover tried to respray them badly. We've got some pretty solid runs on the shiny door, and there must have been even worse runs on the not shiny door because someone has sanded it back with 120 grit sandpaper. Not really sure how that was supposed to fix anything. But anyway, the end result is I have two doors that are a different colour, one of them's shiny and one of them's matte. There's even a handprint left in the paint on this side. Professional job. One thing I do like on the outside of the vehicle are the wheels. These are the nicest looking alloys that Land Rover made, and they have brand new Goodyear Wranglers on them, worth more than the vehicle. The back of the vehicle looks pretty good. No accident damage or anything like that. The rear door is sagging quite a lot. It's actually resting on the bumper down here. And I can see through into the inside up here. I already know why that's happening. I'll show you in a minute. This is a little unfortunate. How am I supposed to discover anything when my Discovery wheel cover is broken? That's an original steel wheel under there. I can tell because it's rusty. The boot lid has the original... Is it a lid? The boot door has the original stickers and stuff on it, so I don't think anything back here has been repaired in the past. Now the glass on the vehicle is pretty good. I haven't noticed any chips or cracks or anything like that. But the seals are complete trash. Everywhere. Which is probably why this vehicle leaks like a sieve. Okay, let's see what's under here. Ah! Why aren't you popped? Perfect. the mighty 3.9 litre Rover V8. Now this vehicle is from 1993. I think they switched to this engine in 1990. So it is fuel injected, electronic fuel injection, and by that I mean it has an ECU, pretty much the same as any modern car. We've got an airflow sensor here, oxygen sensors in the exhaust, and a rail of fuel injectors for each bank.
It's a little bit archaic in the sense that it's still running a basic distributor. This will be an electronic version, of course, meaning it uses a Hall effect sensor in place of points, but still just a basic vacuum advanced distributor.
Let's have a look at the oil. It had about half oil in it when I left. I couldn't be bothered filling it up. And this doesn't mean much because we're on a horrendous slope, but it still has oil in it, so that's a good sign. It doesn't smell like it burns oil, so I don't suspect anything is terribly wrong with the internals of the motor. Coolant. Yep. Pretty much empty and very brown. The previous owner did put a brand new aluminium radiator in it though, so let's see what it looks like in there. Let's not. Plastic, great. Transfer case. Yeah. Has something in it. What is this? ZF. Power steering. Something in it. Let's see what the air cleaner looks like while we're here. Yeah, save that one for later. It's probably perfect. Brand new. Okay, what do you reckon? Cold start time?
So, I've driven this all the way home, about 400 kilometers. Here's my mechanical assessment. Light throttle, it feels like there's no one home. Now, I'm not familiar with this motor, I've never been in a Rover V8 before. Maybe it's just really slow. But I think this Discovery is more gutless than it should be. Until you put your foot right in it, and then it pulls okay. So I don't think there's anything wrong with the basic engine. There could be numerous minor issues with the ignition and fuel injection systems, vacuum leaks, that sort of thing. I know there's at least one vacuum hose flapping in the wind.
Now, the front end. She's a little squirmy and very soft. This thing drives a lot worse than my Series 3 Land Rover did, so something's not quite right. The steering's pretty vague, and mid-corner you sometimes get a tightening and loosening effect, which isn't the most reassuring. It does have pretty big tires on it at the moment, which won't be helping. Could also be a wheel alignment issue, could be a bad ball joint or something in the steering itself. But more worrying than the overall vagueness of the steering, occasionally there's a big clunk. So something is definitely not quite right. Who knows, the mechanical stuff doesn't really faze me. Whatever the problem is, we'll figure it out. Oh, it's me, about half an hour later. I think I found the clunk. Secure. This panel falls off because it's held on with blue tack. Perfect. The Sony radio that I hate anyway is also held in with blue tack. Unfortunately, this console is cracked. A lot. There's a cup holder wood screwed through the dash. Let's check the carpet. Oh, it's a little wet down there, but the carpet's intact. I'll have to keep an eye on that. Something's leaking, probably the sunroof. Let's see if we can get these off. Not too bad. It's pretty gross and damp. This side panel is obviously toast, but this does have 260,000 Ks on it, so this was never going to be perfect. Let's have a look on the other side. These disgusting fluffy covers are going straight to the bin. Oh, plastic, in case you wet your pants. Apparently didn't work. Unfortunately it's pretty filthy. Hopefully that cleans off, because otherwise this seat is in really good condition. What about the carpet down here? Oh, it's also wet, but the carpet looks pretty good. Again, just filthy. I'm really going to have to deal with the leaks, otherwise this interior is going to be trashed very quickly. And the rear seat, let's get rid of these disgusting things. It's also pretty good. Like, really good.
So that's the initial walk around. However, during my drive home, and you might be surprised to hear this, I did discover a few more things that need fixing.
The key's bent. I put the turtles on. None of the locks or door latches work properly. This side unlocks, but doesn't lock. Nope. To lock the car, you have to reach in through the back door and push down. The passenger side, nothing. It also doesn't open. The handbrake needs adjusting. It also doesn't go into park properly. Hopefully the parking lock in the gearbox itself is okay. Speedometer doesn't work. The indicator light thingy works on trailer mode only. I'm pretty sure the air conditioning doesn't work. I couldn't get any heat to come out, and nothing comes out of these windscreen vents. I was trying to get all of that to work in the dark when I didn't really know how it was supposed to work, so some of that might be okay. And I was going to say the clock doesn't work, but it is now. And of course, I mentioned already, the headlights don't really work. I think we may have park in both headlights, but not headlights in both headlights.
Okay, let's cut to the chase. I paid $3,000. First of all, it was the cheapest warranted and registered Discovery for sale. Secondly, in New Zealand at least, crap four-wheel drives don't really bottom out in value like regular cars. Because young guys want them for hunting and ram raids, and it doesn't really matter if the paint is peeling if you're just going to carpet the bonnet or drive it through an ATM machine. Thirdly, I needed a car. I had no intention of purchasing anything the day that I did, but let's just say stuff happened, and I decided that the only way out of a hole was to buy a 30-year-old Land Rover. And when you make a decision like that, the best thing to do is act immediately, which I did. And here we are. I'll leave a comment under the video explaining a little more for those of you who follow the channel closely. But I just want to be clear, this is not a bought for YouTube car. This is my car. Yep. Whether this was a good or bad idea, no, this was definitely a bad idea. Whether this was a ruin my life or turned out okay in the end idea, depends on one thing. Rust.
The worst patch on the outside is just here, inside the rear passenger side door. This whole section is available as a replacement panel, so no big deal. It's a 20-minute job start to finish to cut this out and put a new piece in. But I would imagine as it is now, this will fail its warrant of fitness. And on the driver's side rear door, the upper frame is rusted out in these two spots where it goes into the door. I'm pretty sure this whole frame unbolts from the door itself, so I just need to find one in a wrecking yard and replace it. Now, I do apologize. I couldn't wait to learn my fate. I've already torn into the boot floor. I do have the carpet, it's in good condition like the rest. But as you can see, everything back here is sopping wet. And based on the fact that this rubber has all fallen apart, I think it's been wet for quite a long time. So let me show you the side I've already pulled apart. It does have the fold down seat and everything that goes here, but I've already removed that. A little rusty. It looks pretty bad. I'm not sure if it's as bad as it looks, but it's pretty crusty. Thankfully the wheel wells look pretty good. Someone has put a nasty little patch on this corner here, So no doubt there is a proper hole underneath that. And also, I think this whole panel has been tacked in by somebody to cover something up. Great. Anyway, let's look at the other side. To get to the other side, we need to remove this annoying seat. These are actually pretty cool. Horrifically unsafe by today's standards, but if you don't like your children, you could let them sit back here. Now, these seats are pretty annoying to get out because they're held in with Torx screws. And of course, everybody else who has owned this vehicle has tried to get them out before with Allen keys. So the screw heads are completely rounded on the inside. But bear with me, we'll get there. I hope the previous owners had a nice dog because I sure am breathing in a lot of its hair. Smells like socks. Disgusting. Ah, this is miserable. Ah. That was an hour and a half. Let's have a look. Ah, pretty good. Oh, might be a bit nasty over the back there. Doesn't look too flash. Not too bad. Hang on, I'll get a brush. Oh yeah, that's nothing. That's just dirt. Oh good. So to summarize the boot floor situation, it's a little ugly, but not too bad. I think both sides of the floor will just clean up. Good enough for this vehicle anyway. What is a little bit of a problem is this edge that somebody has covered up under a patch panel in the past. Now, the next problem back here is the corner of this boot door is a little bit shitty. You can see there's obviously rust right here, and that needs repairing, definitely. I can see pinholes through it. But the rust itself isn't that widespread. The bigger problem seems to be, it looks like the door has taken a hit. Maybe somebody has swung off it. This is all pushed up in here. You can see the steel structure has come away from the door skin because this has all been pushed up. So that's gonna be a bit of a pain to fix, but hopefully we can just fix that. We'll have to take the door off to have a look. One of the other trouble spots is underneath the carpets and the footwells. And all of this carpet is wet. You can see how much disgusting mud was hanging out under this cover. Anyway, let's have a look. It's starting, but it hasn't spread. Apart from this one patch here, it looks pretty good. It's potentially bad up in the corner, right where your feet go, but I'm not gonna check that until I pull the carpets right out. Same story on the driver's side. It's starting, but it hasn't really set in yet. In fact, this side's pretty good. Just the tiniest bit of rust starting on top. Now the rest of the underside of the car is perfect. The sills, no surface rust, nothing. The chassis, rust free. The inside of the front fenders, nothing. This vehicle is really clean and dry underneath.
Okay, I bought this to keep forever. Well, assuming the rust isn't too bad. Keep it forever. That's not to say this is a dream car. No, come on. But the early discoveries do interest me enough that, well, here we are. My point is more that there's really no point buying a car this age unless you're intending to keep it forever. Because this discovery is certainly going to cost me more than it's worth to bring it back to a standard that I'm happy with. Right now, this truck is on the verge. It was the last guy's play vehicle, and most likely anyone else who bought it would have had similar ideas. A farm hack or bush truck. But that's not my intention. I want this to be a tidy driver. It looks rough, but I don't think it's too far gone. I'm all about not wasting something that already exists. Yep, that's me, saving the planet by recommissioning Rover V8s. You're welcome. I'm sure Greta thinks it's a good plan too. Thank you all for watching, and hopefully this doesn't get too out of control. I need a car, not another project. Let's see what happens.